I was informed from the organizers that during the lecture, most of the participants are students, and it is better to keep everything very simple. And I observe here that most of them are very aged students. But anyway, it would be good to start from a very introductory part. Today I will speak about the achievement by Baxter about 50 years ago. This is the paper, GMAT piece 1968, but it was submitted in July of 1967. So and the next year is the 15th anniversary. And what is surprising is that Baxter is still working as a representative scientist. And this year, speak about this year. This year is 50th anniversary of the RSRG. Actually, Kadanov submitted a paper of Brock renormalization group in 1966. Unfortunately, he has passed away this year or last year. Last year. Okay. The system I speak about is the dimers on the lattice. In Baxter's article is the dimers on square. This is a simple statistical model. Suppose that there is a square lattice, and you put dimer of the length 1, the length which is equal to the lattice constant on the square lattice, wherever you like. But dimers cannot overlap with each other, and dimers cannot touch with each other. So if there is a dimer here, then these two points, it is forbidden that other dimer can share these four bonds. So it is a kind of hard square model. Hard rectangular model. If there is no empty side, then this system can be solved exactly, and it was the exact solution was given by Leap. But once the empty site is allowed, then it is not solvable. So one has to think about how to extract the thermodynamic property of this system. Let us introduce some parameterization. If the bond is open, if there is no dimer on the bond, then we assume that the bond energy is equal to zero. And if a bond is shared, occupied by a monomer, a dimer, then suppose that the energy of the bond becomes to minus mu. Actually, minus mu, it is just nothing but the chemical potential on the dimer. The partition function of the whole system is written in this form, in this family form, which is the sum of Boltzmann weight. The Boltzmann weight of the whole lattice is given by the minus kVT all the energy on the system divided by kT and multiplied by minus 1. This is the Boltzmann weight of the whole lattice. And taking the configuration sum for all the dimer configurations, you obtain partition function Z. If we regard this minus mu as Gibbs chemical potential, in that case, this is actually a not partition function, but not to the partition function in canonical ensemble, but it is the partition function under the grand canonical ensemble for diamonds. And it is rather tedious to take configuration sum one by one, changing the configuration of diamonds. It is better to introduce some technique. Well, a simple parameterization is not think about the energy of the bond, but consider about the Boltzmann weight according to each bond. So if the bond is opened, then since the energy is zero, so the local Boltzmann weight for the bond is equal to one. And if the bond is occupied by a diamond, in that case, the Boltzmann weight, corresponding Boltzmann weight is E to mu divided by kT. And let us write it as S square, not S, but S square. And this is larger than zero. If S is smaller than zero, then at zero temperature, there is no diamond. And at finite temperature, some diamonds are allowed to exist, but they are randomly, sparsely distributed. And when S equals larger than zero, then at zero temperature, all the lattice is occupied by diamonds. And there might be some order, and there might not be. So it has to be checked. Now we introduce Boltzmann weight according to but each lattice point. This model is not the site model, but the degrees of freedom is on the bond. So it is better to attribute Boltzmann weight for each lattice point, each vertex, say. This point is called the vertex since four roads meet here, and it is a kind of vertex in the road, on the road. Since if there is a diamond here, then the corresponding weight is S square. So it is possible to consider that half of S is belongs to the upper vertex, and half of them belongs to the lower one. So let us divide the Boltzmann weight S square into two and define local Boltzmann weight with respect to each vertex. So if consider a vertex, and if there is no diamond on four bonds, then since there is no energy, so the corresponding Boltzmann weight for this vertex is equal to one. And other possibility, there are only four other possibilities in this case. With that is only one bond is occupied by a diamond. And other three bonds are opened. In this case, one of the bond is occupied, and let us write that occupied. Let us denote the occupied bond by the number one and empty bond by the number zero. Then these four configurations are allowed for bonds, and the corresponding Boltzmann weight is equal to S. As an exercise, please check that if you align two vertices and the bond is occupied by a monomer, then in that case, here you have weight S and here you have S. Thus, the whole weight is S squared as it was expected. This is the definition of the model. We can consider many generalization of this model, and we can play, enjoy, investigation on thermodynamics. And I might touch that if I have a time. Okay. Up to here. Don't you have any question? Okay. Then let's move to the next. So the task is to obtain the partition function. Partition function with respect to the vertex length. Well, what, where is the best place for the camera? For the camera?
Is it better to put it here?
And is that, is this, is everything visible? Okay. So let us write the vertex weight in this manner. And call it weight, name the weight as k. And it has four indices, four legs. So this is four leg tensor in our terminology. It is rather tedious to write square each time. So often this vertex weight, this pictorial representation of the vertex weight is simplified by cross mark in the field of statistical mechanics. Well, this is the Baxter's notation. If we use this notation, then the transfer matrix, there are two types of transfer matrices. One is row-to-row transfer matrix to the vertical direction, and the other is the column-to-column transfer matrix to horizontal direction. For the time being, let us consider row-to-row transfer matrix. The row-to-row transfer matrix is nothing but multiplying this vertex weight horizontally in a row, aligned in a row. The horizontal bar represents auxiliary variable in MPO. This is equals to M matrix product operator in our terminology. Let us put quotations. The quotation means that this is our terminology. And this transfer matrix and vertex length, that's Baxter's terminology. The graphical representation of the transfer matrix, row-to-row transfer matrix B, or sometimes this is written as transfer matrix T, but anyway. In Baxter's paper, the transfer matrix is written by B. If we use the notation, then transfer matrix is written in this manner. And horizontal direction, one might think about the boundary condition. Sometimes the boundary conditions are important, especially when there is topological degrees of freedom. But in this case, in the case of diver, there is no such complication. So you can leave it open, or you can consider tilted boundary condition. Or you can arbitrarily set up the boundary condition when the system is not critical. Since we consider the thermodynamic limit later. Then by using the transfer matrix, you can write down the partition function as the trace of a stack of transfer matrices m times. if the width of the system is n, if the width of the system is n, then this is just by considering m by n system. This is equivalent to consider the system of with the size m by n, and therefore the transfer matrix, no, partition function is written in the trace of the stack of transfer matrices. And if m is sufficiently large, so the number, if the number of transfer matrices is sufficiently large, then it is well known that the partition function is well approximated by its largest eigenvalue if there is no degeneracy. And in this case, there is no degeneracy. Our aim is to find out the maximum eigenvalue of the transfer matrix. Of course, it is better to obtain it exactly, but sometimes it is not possible. So in that case, we have to think about some other method. Baxter introduced variational ansatz. So any variational vector, consider any variational vector, then we can think about the variational estimate for the largest eigenvalue of the transfer matrix V. Just by taking the expectation value of V and divided by the norm of V, norm of the variational state. So we have written the variational state by psi. Well, sometimes the variational state is written in the Dirac bracket notation. So what is the realistic candidate for this variational vector?
Sorry, Tomotoshi?
Yeah.
This would be to the power k, no?
K.
No, I think it varies. It's per row, by this per row variation.
Variational partition function per row.
Yeah. I mean the eigenvalue, no? Because you define gamma as the eigenvalue of V.
Gamma is eigenvalue of V. Yeah.
Yes. So then you have V to the K, no?
It's kind of like you would understand this. You could say
I speak about it.
It's
kind of cartoon picture of what this variational state should be.
So the realistic choice of this variational vector psi can be obtained just by multiplying the transfer matrix many times, k times, to some an arbitrary vector, which is not orthogonal to the maximal state. So this is the pictorial representation of such a construction. So if you prepare some arbitrary state and just by stacking transfer matrices. Is it not clear? Yeah. Okay. And if you use this construction, this variational estimate becomes better and better if you increase the number k. Of course, the transfer matrix V itself is many dimensional, and it increases, the matrix dimension increases exponentially with respect to the system size n. It is hopeless to directly calculate, obtain such a vector. I give the pictorial representation of this variational ratio. Suppose that psi is constructed in this manner. Then The denominator is just the contraction of two, two sides, and the numerator is just by contraction among two psi's and b. So here there is a, an additional transfer layer which corresponds to the transfer matrix D. Well, looking at such a stacking construction of the variational candidate of the maximal vector for the transfer matrix D, one finds that this can be decomposed vertically. So this is Baxter's notation. This variational state created by stacking transfer matrix k times can be written as trace of some matrix G. Matrix, but actually this is a three-leg tensor. So this is just by a tensor is just by pulling out this vertical part. So this is just the horizontal, horizontally aligned tensor. This variational state can be written as a horizontal stack of this element.
So you assume the just a direct product state for the initial state phi over there.
Ah, okay, okay. yeah. Okay. One has to prepare a direct product state in such a decomposition. So let us write it in this manner. So here is a, an element of product state, and here is the vertical stack of vertices. So in such a manner, you can construct variational state. So this is Baxter's notation, and in your notation, we have to prepare some box and put the name in the box and write all the things that coming out from the tensor. So if we use this notation, then the variational state can be written in such a horizontal row or stack of three-leg tensors. Well, Baxter stated in his paper that such a construction of the variational state is invariant. In our terminology, this is gauge invariance. So invariant under the transformation, unitary or orthogonal transformation. Well, since Baxter considers statistical models, so actually, this is a real orthogonal matrix, so not unitary. But anyway, conceptually the same. So up to here, I have mentioned about the construction of the variational state. Well, it is possible to calculate the expectation value of the largest transfer eigenvalue by using such a construction. So it can be, if people know up to here, one can start numerical calculation. Here is an interesting description in the well-known paper. This that is Nightingale Braid, Fizz Red B33659. In 1986. This paper is well known since this is the first numerical proof or numerical support, okay, support, numerical support about the existence of the Haldane gap. So this paper is well known among people. And critically reading the whole part of the paper, then as a, how do you say, supplement, you find out this sentence. generalization to quantum mechanical system is straightforward. What's generalization? This is a statement about the Baxter's construction of the variational state. So in Nightingale-Brett, he says that Baxter's construction of the variational state can be applied to quantum state. And to them, that is straightforward. Yeah. So if they apply Baxter's method according to their intuition, then everything starts from 1986. But we should have wait another several years before Stephen White established the density matrix renormalization group. This is a bit of history. Okay, so the next subject, our next subject is how to optimize the variational tensor. Well, do I have a space? It might be better to rotate. The bad side is white. I expect that the bad side is not occupied. My plan was to spend an hour up to here. I consumed only 30 minutes. Okay. The next. Since a tensor is gauge invariant, so now if you apply the gauge transformation to the horizontal row stack of variables, so originally the tensor G has many legs. Many row lengths that takes either 1, 0, 1, 0. So originally the tensor, variational tensor G, has a stack of row spin variables. But after one applies the gauge transformation, unitary or orthogonal transformation, then the horizontal leg loses its original meaning. So it might be better to just by denote the horizontal degrees of freedom by thick line. So now it is a variational problem to consider the variational ratio for an arbitrary choice of variational tensor, local tensor G. Now, it is convenient to consider transfer matrix to horizontal direction. In this case, I cannot flip, since I cannot flip the platform. In the variational formation, one has to consider the ratio. And since every part is constructed by the local tensor, so it is possible to consider vertical slice. And a vertical slice is written in this manner. So from the denominator, here is G. Okay. Here is a G. And here is another G. Also here is a G. Here is another G. So from the denominator, you obtain such a combination of vertical slice. So actually, two G's are in this slice. And from the numerator, you obtain such a vertical slice that contains a two variational tensors and one vertex here. Okay. And since everything is the horizontal stack, so now we can consider the eigenvalue equation, eigenvalue relation with respect to the horizontal direction, toward the horizontal direction. So suppose that this horizontal transfer matrix has some eigenvector x, and suppose that eigenvalue is xi, and also consider the horizontal eigenvalue relation with respect to the extended horizontal transfer matrix. Then you have some eigenvector p, and the eigenvalue, corresponding eigenvalue, is eta. Of course, you can imagine that x is nothing but the vertical stack of g's, and p is nothing but the not the vertical, horizontal stack of this extended transfer matrix. So actually, x and p has some geometrical meaning. Actually, both x and p corresponds to the right half of the whole system. So using these notations, actually, one can write down the partition function per side. Since now, Cauchy represent a partition function per this area, this vertical area, and eta represent some partition function corresponding to the extended vertical area. So actually, by taking the ratio between eta and xi, so if one divide eta by xi, then one obtain the partition function per side. This is the variational estimate of the partition function per side, per vertex. And if we multiply from the left side the same eigenvector x and p, we just obtain the scalar eta and xi. So this division, if we write down this division by picture, then we can represent the variational ratio in this manner. This is rather complicated, but you eventually find it. And you don't have to understand the structure right now. So the point is how to maximize the partition function per side. So at this moment, Baxter considers the stationary condition. Stationary condition means that since this partition, variational partition function per side, is a functional of the variational tensor. So to the infinitesimal change of variational tensor, the value of kappa should be stationary. So from the stationary condition, it takes some time and it is not written in the paper, but the final result is written. One obtains some generalized eigenvalue relation with respect to the eigenstate of the horizontal transfer matrix also the horizontal extended transfer matrix and G and K. This form is actually very useful and appears again in our context. So if we try to apply such a variational construction to two-dimensional quantum system or three-dimensional classical system, we encounter such generalized eigenvalue relation again.
So only G is variational parameter?
Only G.
So P and X is determined by G?
Yeah. So P and G are determined by this eigenvalue relation. So only G are the variational element.
So you have to repeat, I mean.
Yeah, one has to repeat.
But is it clear that the lower expression can always be diagonalized?
Ah.
I was asking if one does it for a matrix product operator of some Hamiltonian.
Okay.
Then it can only be brought to a Jordan form, or maybe this doesn't
apply. Yeah, that is an important point. So in this case, since every vertex is symmetric, so everything is symmetric and Hermitian. So one can prove the presence of diagonal form. But if one consider asymmetric model or random system, the situation is completely different. And in that case, we have to modify. And actually, asymmetric case is very, the treatment of the asymmetric case is the frontier in our field.
But I guess that anyway you would have the exponential
Hamiltonian there. You can assume the presence of such an optimized variational tensor, as Luca says, that just by obtaining those stacking the vertices.
Mm-hmm.
But it's almost infinitely dimensional tensor. So that is not useful for in the numerical calculation.
Thank you. So why is that a constant? This
Here is a constant. Yeah. Why? Is it? Oh, the constant multiplied by that. Multiplied. And next week, Philip Kolbotz might speak about this point when he applied two-dimensional tensor product to two-dimensional Heisenberg system, he probably treats a Heisenberg system. And we actually applied this generalized we means that Okunishian I and Maeshima Genya, etc. Applied this generalized eigenvalue problem to three-dimensional Ising model. Preparing two-dimensional tensor product state. But probably the article, the journal we submitted was not well known in those days. We submit our article to Progress of Theoretical Physics. Do you know that journal? Does everyone know that journal? About half. I hope that everyone knows it also the TPET, which?
TPET.
Okay. Anyway, this you encounter such a generalized eigenvalue problem every time you consider such a variational construction. So after here, everything is so clear. But Baxter did not stop here. He then considered to divide this eigenstate of horizontal transfer matrix into two parts. Since it has geometrical meaning, So just taking by the square root of x, suppose that it is possible to take some square root, or even when it is not possible, you can perform singular variety composition or something else to divide that, the eigenvector into two parts. This is actually a corner transfer matrix. So this is the origin of the corner transfer matrix. Well, as we have seen that the whole variational state is invariant under the gauge transformation, and Baxter took the gauge where this square root of x is diagonal. Actually, this is nothing but a diagonalized corner transfer matrix. And let us write it by A. So when A appears, it is the corner transfer matrix after the diagonalization. So now we have three elements. That is diagonalized corner transfer matrix, a variational tensor, and vertex. And since we have treating isotropic system, so everything in the vertical direction is the same as everything in the horizontal direction, to the horizontal direction. So this eigenvalue program can be written in this manner. So P is now can be written in the combination of a corner transfer matrix and a variational tensor, also another corner transfer matrix is here. And to this part, to this eigenstate, candidate of the eigenstate, you multiply extended horizontal transfer matrix to obtain eta times original vector. So this is the eigenvalue relation toward the horizontal direction using the corner transfer matrix.
So could you explain why the corner transfer matrix for X is common to the common corner transfer matrix for P?
Okay. First of all, if we do not apply the gauge transformation, then actually everything here is the stack of vertices. So this part is the stack of vertices, and this is just a horizontal row of vertices. And also in the upper part, there is a stack of vertices.
Okay.
So this part and this part is the same. So after the gauge transformation, everything looks like this. So this is Baxter's construction. And if you look at this part, consists of an A and 2G and K. And you eventually find out that this has the same structure as original corner transfer matrix. So if there is a corner transfer matrix here, you can put variational tensor here and put another vertex here to extend the area of the corner transfer matrix. So Baxter already introduced the concept of extension of corner transfer matrix in his article. After here, everything is the same as the what is done in CTMRG, corner transfer matrix normalization group.
Sorry,
yeah.
Can you explain to me why the G? So you are in the gauge in which A is diagonal. That's the
yeah.
In which okay.
Sorry. Okay. So I have nothing. No additional volume. If I am a magician, I flip it again, but it's impossible. So let us use blackboard. Yeah, here is my note. So, from the construction, one can obtain eigenvalue relation. Like that. Just by modifying this relation a bit. One obtains this. Here is extended C. Actually, this consists of K here and G here, G here, and A here. A and a bond, vertical bond, is here. G is here, and A is here. Is equal to, no. Is equal to, eta. A is here, A, and G is here, and A is here again. What is written here on the board is the same as the diagram. I don't know. Baxter is very, very, how to say, a craftsman. In that sense, that he find out some eigenvalue relation from with respect to, I have to put another point here. With respect to the corner trans matrix, just by this part is C. So this is equal to C. Let us multiply A inverse here. A inverse here. A inverse. Also, A inverse here. Okay. Since A inverse A inverse A is equal to 1, equals to A inverse. So it is possible to write it down as eta. Multiplied by A here and A inverse here, G here. Find out A inverse GA here and also A inverse GA here. It means that A inverse GA, A GA inverse, the opposite. A GA inverse is a candidate for eigenvector of C. So if she has if she has some if we diagonalize the extended corner transform matrix and obtain its eigenvalue and eigenstate, we have some information. And suppose that we keep sufficiently large number of state for this auxiliary space, and suppose that everything is how to say recursive. Everything is recursive. So here we prepare A in the diagonal form, and if we diagonalize A, C, the extended transfer matrix C, then diagonalization so if we diagonalize C, then we might have some diagonal form where on the left corner there is A, and here is zero, here is zero, and here is a minor eigenvalues. Once we extend the corner transfer matrix, diagonal corner transfer matrix, and put a variational tensors and a variational horizontal vertex, and by extending the corner transfer matrix in this manner and diagonalize it, then the eigenvalue structure should be in this form. A comes here again, and some minor eigenvalues comes here. So, and its eigenvector. And eigenvector. If we align the eigenvector of C in the vertical direction, it means that considering the eigenvalue relation CQ equals to QD, and this is the matrix D, and this is matrix Q. I have to put yes, it's okay. And no, I have to put eta here. Eta. But anyway, this is eigenvalue relation. So, and D is diagonal. And Q is orthogonal. Orthogonal. And C is extended.
We have to put the eta. That's from the previous equation, but now you're just trying to diagonalize the extended.
Okay. Let us erase. In that case, I have to put here eta A. Eta A. Eta A multiplied by eta.
You multiply it into the definition of your extended?
Yeah.
So in the upper, you still have an extra A, right? So is this just an eigenvalue problem?
Yes. So one might find out the reason why eta appears here. Because eta is a partition function with respect to here. With respect to K and 2Gs. And in the extension process of corner transfer matrix, 2Gs and K appears. So after the diagonalization, then the factor eta appears. This is difficult point to understand in Baxter's notation. But anyway, after the diagonalization, one of the extended corner transfer matrix, one of the matrix, rectangular matrix Q, which we call normalization or isometry, and the diagonal matrix, matrix, which we call singular values in our context. Well, from here, Baxter have chosen some different scheme. So from the queue, as I stated that this part of Q is equal to AG in A inverse. So in the thermodynamic limit. So
question, does the form of D is a kind of approximation or exact?
Approximation. Yeah. Approximation, and which might become exact in the thermodynamic limit.
Mm, yeah.
assuming that this relation closes even when we have finite degrees of freedom here for chi degrees of freedom, then it is possible to obtain a closed equation, with respect to G and A. So by solving it iterationally, we finally reaches the fixed point and obtain the variational, fully optimized variational tensor G. That is Baxter's strategy. Speak about its fixed point. The fixed point obtained by Baxter's iterative method is the same as our method using density matrix normalization or corner transform normalization group or PEPs or anything. Baxter established a way to obtain or optimize variational tensor G in his paper. So this is Baxter's construction.
Sorry, Tomotoshi.
Yeah.
Why you inverted now A and A to minus 1? Because that was A minus 1 GA, no?
Here in the left hand side, there is A minus 5 G A. And here there is A G A.
No, this I agree, but then you wrote on the right that A G A minus 1 is candidate for a vector.
Ah, okay. Please look at that. This is left index and this is right index. And at the right index, here A comes first and G next and G. Yeah. But this construction is very tedious, requires many iterations to obtain the self-consistent equation. After we know the MRG, so up to here, everything was done by Baxter. So after DMRG, what's DMRG? As everyone knows that DMRG is a renormalization group scheme applied to one-dimensional quantum system. And if there is a renormalized block at site, then one can define larger block by applying unitary or orthogonal transformation. We might, in the terminology, in our way of writing a tensor, it is like that. So yeah, if there is G here, then these two are renormalized into one by applying isometry here. And this is equal to G prime. This is the scheme in DMRG. So if we do not put it and we extend everything. To put C here, then G here, again K here, A here. Then what we obtain would be G here and A here. And here is theta dash. Yeah, this is the construction in CTFRG. So this point is the crucial difference between Baxter's formulation and corner transfer matrix normalization group. Well, probably it might not. I don't have time to speak about the detail of the corner transfer matrix. Okay. So let us speak about some extension. Generalization. Do you have?
So in terms of the computational complexity, will this CTMRG be more demanding than the original one because you have to double it somehow?
Okay, since original Baxter's formulation requires self-consistency,
yes.
So every matrix, every tensor should have the same dimension.
Hmm.
So there is no isometry in it. That's why everything should be repeated within the same matrix dimension, and this is it is easy when everything is isometric, isotropic. But for example, if there is a distinction between horizontal and vertical direction, one has to consider it again. Of course, even in that case, one can obtain the self-consistent equation in Baxter's manner. But in the case when the horizontal degrees of freedom is different from vertical degrees of freedom, for example, if the horizontal degrees of freedom is 3 and vertical degrees of freedom is 2, in that case one has to consider self-consistency again. It is possible to obtain some self-consistent equation also, but finally, if one considers some modulated system or a disordered system, it's over. So in that case, we have to throw out the self-consistency in Baxter's notation, and we have to understand, write it everything in the manner of DMRG, which extends the system side by side, place by place. That's instead. So now, from now, I impose some homeworks to those participants who are so skilled about the tensor network. Well, that is some example is rows. Considered dimers on the lattice, and also it is possible to consider rods. A simple extension is polydispersive case. Polydispersive means that some rods are very short and some rods are long. That can be simply represented by such a Boltzmann wave. This is 0, 0. The empty vertex is 1. The weight for the empty one is 0. And S, and its rotation, including its rotation, and also 1, 1, 0, 0. Just by putting, assuming these Boltzmann weight, one consider.
So the zeros and ones may be opposite.
Thank you for the correction. Zero and one is opposite. Here is zero. Here is one. Here is one. Thank you. In this case, you can represent, so if here is a lattice, and if here is a loads of length 2, then here there is S, and here there is another S, and here S square. So the weight for this load is S to 4. S, and twice as large as the length of the load. And suppose that S is sufficiently large, and temperature is low, very low. So in the low temperature, what you obtain is horizontally or vertically aligned loads. And some load is very short, and other loads is very long. But since it is difficult.
Sorry, low temperature means small s, or?
Pardon?
Low temperature means very small s?
Low temperature means larger s. Larger s. So if s is sufficiently large, you loads are everywhere. And everywhere is packed by long loads. And there are two cases. Either you obtain horizontally loads or vertical loads. And in high temperature, what you obtain is a disordered distribution of short loads. So there is a transition. What kind of transition shall we encounter? Well, this is we have two cases in a low temperature. So there is a kind of Z2 symmetry. I don't know whether we have a precise Z2 symmetry or not. Probably there is. And this is disorder. So there is Ising transition. This is very easily be verified if one performs some calculation using quantum asymmetric minimization group or any some other methods. This is easy. But the problem is rows. Fixed rows. Real problem exists in rows in fixed length. How can we parameterize, how can we define such a model so that every bond, every row has a fixed length? Such a model. This model has long history. Actually, Onsaga stated that if we consider such a model, then we encounter phase transition. And in free space, we might encounter first order transition. On the lattice, we don't know what happens. And it might depend on the ratio between the activity or between the density and the length. Okay, density and of the rods and length. The transition might be related to the density and the length of the rods. Well, Monte Carlo simulation shows that if the length L is shorter than 3, there is nothing. Every phase is disordered at any temperature. 4 or 5 is a critical. Kawashima-san, do you know that?
No. Okay.
Tomotoshi,
yeah.
Is the length and the size of the lattice relative? So I mean, you would expect that L equal 4 with the lattice of 40 is equal to L equal 2 with the lattice of 20, or not? So I would expect that there is some relation between the length of the rod and the size of your lattice.
Mm-hmm.
Or define size, no?
Size of the lattice is infinite.
Okay.
Size is infinite. So please consider infinite size. Well, so in this case, you have to, how to say, do some trick, impose some trick on the local vertex to make the every road has the same length. Well, so in order to impose such a constraint, you have to impose, prepare such a way. This is, first of all, if nothing, there is nothing, the weight is 0, 0, 0, 0. And I only write the speed, the horizontal rods only, and you know that to keep the time. And please imagine what happens to the vertical direction. Then the left end is like that. Zero. In the middle. In the middle. 0, 0, 1, 1. I don't know. I plus. And then I. Is like one, eight, 0, 0, 0. And so in this case is I equal to 1 smaller than L minus 1. So in order to represent the rows of fixed length L, we have to prepare such a vertex weight. So we have to deal with L plus 1 degrees of freedom. We have to treat L equals to 1 degrees of freedom.
It should be L, right?
I mean, L minus 1 should be
the last one is L.
Yeah, last one is there, yes.
And
so
you have only
up to
the I plus one.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Please forget.
Okay.
Oh, okay, I see.
Yeah. So, first of all, you have to deal with L plus 1 degrees of freedom. So, the expression is very large. Even for L equals to 5, D equals to 6. And one might say that D equals 6 is nothing in our computation. It's right. But please note that the model is asymmetric. So here is 0 and 1. But there is no 1 and 0. If you cannot put 1 and 0, because if you once you put 1 and 0, then you obtain diamond. 0 and 1 and 0. So this is diamond. So you shouldn't put 1 and 0 in this. So this is asymmetric. So this asymmetry causes some numerical problem. But this can be overcome. We know how to deal with asymmetric matrices. But the real problem exists in the entanglement structure. So consider that we have some order state. Suppose that here is the roads are aligned vertically. We call such a vertically aligned state as nematic state. In the tensor network calculation, or in corner transfer matrix optimization, or any other, we construct density matrix. We by cutting the system into two. But since the length of the rod is always equal to n, so if there is some length a, then there should be remaining length l minus a here. So actually, these two degrees of freedom. One is living here in the upper lower border, and the other is living in the upper border, are strongly entangled. That's why if we check the entanglement spectrum, then actually we encounter very severe situation that entanglement increases linearly. Entanglement itself increases linearly with respect to the system size. It means that the application of our scheme is not efficient. And this is the difficulty I have been encountering for this.
In this case, you could exploit the asymmetry, right? Because in the other direction, if you use
vertical cut.
Yes.
You are right. Oh, in this construction, it is possible to. But how can exclude the situation? Since the model is isotropic. Isotropic means that the physics itself is isotopic. And is there any way to align? Okay, you can impose some weak field.
Boundary condition? Yeah, impose
boundary condition to erase such a possibility that roads across the aligned in the manner that it crosses the cut. Yeah, you are right in this case. That is a trial. That is a candidate of how did this model. Here is a minor comment that if we consider the assembly of crosses, so if there are crosses on the square, then in this case you cannot avoid. So anyway, if there is a matter, there if we consider some statistical mechanics of those systems that has a finite size, we have to be careful to the entanglement structure. And this is the homework to your, homework means that this is the problem I have not solved yet. That's why I impose it as a homework since this is a lecture. We find out such a homework in Feynman's textbook. Anyway, in Feynman's textbook. And further extension is possible. Squares, rectangles. So it is possible to consider assembly of rectangles just by introducing a such cross. So a square is constructed by this cross vertex. It is possible to consider such a square. And in the previous passive case, we obtain first order phase transition. So in the high temperature, here and there are small squares or small rectangles are distributed. And as we lower the temperature, their size start to increase. And about the temperature that each square tends to overlap, then eventually every vertex, every side is occupied by one, and the system goes to a completely ordered state. And this transition is first order. So actually, we can enjoy various types of phase transition on such a simple construction. And also,
a question to the first order phase transition, the Lattice symmetry is broken.
Not broken. Totally asymmetric.
So what is the size of the square that you have considered?
Effectively infinite. We can always consider thermodynamic limit.
The size of the squares.
Size of the squares.
Yeah.
In this case, for this passive, so small and large. So according to, so the Boltzmann weight is equal to the exponential of area of the square, rectangle.
Have you also considered the Montes first case?
No. That's difficult. So that has the same problem as where I've stated. Please consider. It's your topic. And also, three-dimensional generalizations are also possible. So straightforward. So dimers on three-dimensional lattice can be easily solved by tensor network, tensor product state variational formulation. And I suppose the roads of short roads of a fixed length can be treated also. But I have never seen such an application. Also, three-dimensional generalization of boxes in the space can be studied. So there are many choices, and also one can choose lattice proteins. So proteins of fixed length can be studied in the same manner. And speak about this example, endic carbon. Once treated the system by a DMRG, and he got some result. Please type endic carbon across DMRG. You might have find out the paper. So speak about the statistical application of tensor network formulations. Actually, a variety of system is waiting for you. And for those who are suffering from giving an appropriate subject to students and postdocs, please distribute such a thing. Okay, thank you.
In the fixed rod case or in the fixed rectangle case or so. I mean, the problem itself is completely, whatever, at least reflection symmetric, right? So, but still you cannot find a reflection symmetric MPO decomposition.
Okay, I understand what you say.
But there's no reason for it. All we know is that if you have a symmetry, then there's a way to implement up to a gauge transformation, which probably is the case, right? This thing is reflection symmetric up to a gauge.
Right.
Which constantly labels L as 1 and L minus 1 as 2 and so on. Right?
It's just in this case you cannot find a representation of the virtual level that is trivial.
Which tells you that there is a point behind the steel on the gauge. Right?
It seems that the mathematician besides you already have some answers. So okay. So at least I don't find it, but there might be. So please consider. Thank you.
Actually, I still don't understand what actually is the homework. So what?
okay. Homework is okay. To Kawashima-san, since you are special, it's the Monte Carlo simulation. There is no difficulty to treat this. Okay. So we have a frustration when a system can be treated by Monte Carlo, but cannot be treated by our method by tensor network. And in the field of tensor network, the point is the constraint. So if we have to create density matrix, but if here is a density L, then there should be L minus N. So there is a...
So the problem is, in that kind of configuration, entanglement entropy seems to be large. I mean, it should not be so large. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, that's it. And also you can compute the Reni entropy from the Monte Carlo simulation.
Yes.
So please calculate it. You understand, eventually.
So have you tried different methods, different tensor network methods for these kinds of models besides CTMRG? Other like TNR, for instance, or TRG?
No, not TRG. No. TRG is possible. TNR, non trivial. It's your homework.
Okay, then let's start the lecture again.